Hello, everybody. Chris Frederick from the Stretch to Win Institute, stretchtowin.com. I'm here on what we call Football Fridays with one of my colleagues, friends, and one of my graduates, Jeff Kong. Jeff Kong, could you introduce yourself
Hey, Chris.
And what you do?
Yeah, my name is Jeff Kong. I own Tri-Covery Massage and Flexibility here in southeastern Michigan. We are the official massage and stretch providers for the Detroit Lions. Go Lions. And we work with a lot of different athletes, but also a lot of people who are not in the athletic world, or not familiar with even the fitness world, dealing with injuries and helping them recover.
Cool.
So, yeah.
So last time we talked about a bunch of different things in our last interview. To my memory, we talked about the dangers of turf versus grass a little bit on the body. We talked about a certain maneuver we call the reverse hip opener.
Yes.
That we teach that gets the obturator internus, that elusive muscle that a lot of people just
and
cannot.
The deep one.
Yeah, and you can't access it. And we talked about how that movement completely accesses and gets to that muscle to activate it, inhibit it, release scar tissue, whatever you want. Today, we're not sure what we want to talk about. So I just worked on someone yesterday. He is a cornerback. He's a veteran, 14 years. He made a big play in the Super Bowl with Green Bay or something some years ago. And he kind of was a big name, and it's been 14 years and he's still trying to, you know, basically stay in the league and do his good work. And he has a fantastic body. This guy, man, 14 year veteran, feels like,
wow,
honestly, his body feels like a 20 year old.
No kidding. 14 years is a long
rare,
time in the NFL.
Rare. Okay.
Yeah.
And this is what I want to talk about. This is the type of person, I verified this with him. I said, dude, tell me if I'm wrong. Have you been flexible your whole life? Have you been, compared to other guys in high school when you played, in college when you played, in the pros, all those years, did people just think you were crazy flexible? He said, yes. I said, uh-huh, I thought so. Now, my other question is, have you had difficulty with trainers of any kind or therapists trying to stretch you, saying, hey, you're good? He said, yeah, they think I'm so flexible that I don't have any issues there. And he says, but I know that's wrong, after coming to see you, Chris, and Ann at Stretch to Win. I said, why is that? Because you find the places where my body does have imbalances, where I do have restrictions that everybody else just whizzed past, blew past, could not find. So I'd like to talk a little bit about that, at least my experience, and see what your experience is.
Yeah.
With apparently the super flexible, you know, he's not flexible for a dancer, because he's
football,
not a
football
dancer.
Player. Yeah.
Yeah, he's a football player, so he's
for
exceptionally
his sport.
Yeah, he's exceptionally flexible for a football player, and there's a bunch of guys, let's say, in the top 1% or whatever, that are really have really good flexibility from all apparent when you look at it and you examine it, you assess it. But honestly, I have to pull out some advanced maneuvers. Okay, if you're level one certified with us, you don't have the training for that. Level two, getting there, you got to go above, you know, and beyond. Yeah, you got to get into two and three level, our advanced training, because, and you need years behind you, which you have, working on football players to really understand their bodies. And then with these guys, the cornerbacks that backpedal, quick, fast turns this way, that way, exceptional. They have to jump to catch interceptions. They got to block. They got to do everything. They're amazing athletes. And they got to be fast, super fast to catch up with those fast wide receivers. So, and then they got to turn their head looking, you know, wide receivers has to turn their head at the same time looking for the ball. So anyway, you know, I go through the movements that we do and I'm like, okay, he's good here. He's good here. I don't waste any time. I'm not going to stretch him where he doesn't need it, obviously. But then I'm keying in on what he needs, and he has an imbalance on the left versus the right with reverse hip opener. I find it, okay, seemingly flexible, left side more restricted than the right. So I need his left to match the right.
Mm-hmm.
He's a cornerback. He needs to play both sides of the field, right?
Yeah.
He's got to move evenly and pivot and twist and turn and accelerate and decelerate from either end. So I have to get him really balanced out, and he has a deficit on that left side. So I found that interesting. And it went up to the chain. It was a spiral net, and it went into his upper body. I found it in the I found it actually in his thoracic.
Okay.
that was limited in rotation. And so when I did the dish rag with him and I held his pelvis down and I lifted his scapula off and I gave him a big old twist, brrr, only on the left, all facet releases, on the right, zero and no restrictions. It was incredible.
Interesting.
Yeah, it was really interesting to see. Wow, if I didn't do the dish rag, honestly, I wouldn't have felt this because it's rotation from above. We do rotation a lot from below, as you FST practitioners know, when we have our hand on the sacrum and we do the typical rotation of a lumbar, lumbo, thoracic, you got to rotate from thoracic down.
Yes.
Okay, that's the, we don't call it dish rag, we call it sweet roll now. We used to call it dish rag, it's called sweet roll. You know?
I
But this
love the
is,
name.
yeah, this is sweet roll though, with not short lever arms, which is, let's say, hand on L5, hand on L4. It's hand on the ASIS in the front of the pelvis and on the same side behind on the scapula. Deep breath, hold that pelvis down and really lift and rotate the whole spine nice and easy. Not fast and violent. It's not a high velocity, low amplitude chiropractic adjustment. We're not doing that. But it's a nice mobilizing stretch that releases that whole side. He was like, wow, I didn't know I was so restricted on that one side.
It's interesting. You had a bunch of noise on one side, and the other, it was like it was nothing.
Yeah, so my
That tells you
point,
how uneven he was. Yeah.
and he feels like I've stretched a lot of people that run fast. I stretched a lot of people in track, sprinters, all 100s, 200s, you know, fast people, right? And a lot of those people have, like when I used to stretch Sanya Richards, her name is now Sanya Richards Ross, she used to be the
Yeah.
fastest 400 in the world. I was like, man, she's so flexible. Same thing. She has it all. No wonder she's a world champion, you know. But this is when she was 19. She didn't even win her first gold medal yet when we were working
Wow.
here. But you could tell, like, this is an elite body. She's got it all: strength, speed, flexibility. But sure enough, man, you start searching. They got their tight corners, and that's a game changer. That could be milliseconds on the clock, which is a lot of time in track.
Yeah, that could be the difference right there.
That could
And
be the difference.
it's interesting with these high-level athletes like that, how you really have to put on a detective hat to really figure out how deep you need to look into for dysfunctions, because they cover it up so well and
Yes.
they compensate for things so well.
So with bent knee, hip flexion, super range of motion, no problem there. Out to the side, no problem. Most of its time, they have to go on a diagonal. It's usually on the diagonal crossing midline where you start picking it up. And even then, when they're super flexible on a diagonal, you still got to go into, now when I'm talking about where I find it is, you go into the glutes. And so when you go into the glutes, a lot of those runners, you know, I'm talking the African Americans, typical sprinter, a lot of them have super internal rotation. But they have deficits with the external rotation in the glute stretch. In fact, their leg doesn't want to do that. And that's part of the trick, is to open that up, to get the hips to open up even more. And it's, you got to use your hips, like Ann shows us, you got to really scoop it in level two. We show you how to scoop that sucker. And avoiding the hamstring. So you don't want to go from glute. You try to go from glute to glute max without hitting the hamstring, which is difficult sometimes with these people, with the fast twitchers, especially if they have tightness behind the popliteal as well.
Yeah.
When you start extending the knee, even if you go to 90 degrees of knee flexion, it's like, oh, I feel it in my hamstring. That's me, actually. My body's like that too. And so the trick is really working with that proper knee angle when you get from piriformis, glute medius, glute maximus. And then if you can even do external rotation, a lot of times I can't even get that the typical way. So I'm just scooping it, level two style, just to try to get it. And that seems to really help. And then level two sack of buns works more than level one. Because with level two, I get my sacrum under that thigh bone, under the femur, and boy, do I lift that femoral head out of that socket and work it, work it, work it, as I say in one of my videos.
Earn that money.
Yeah, doing that, you know, therapeutic twerking, shall we call it?
Fascial stretch twerking,
Yeah,
FST,
the
right? Is that what
FST
it is?
practitioners know what I'm saying if you're level two and above. If you're level one, you're going to have to twerk in level two. But we have a lot of fun with that move, and that's a way to get even deeper. Level two is all about getting deeper in the hip socket into the capsule, where a lot of the magic lies in terms of scar tissue and restrictions.
Yeah, that's I've noticed that a lot. The imbalance, especially with the punters and kickers, with their, you know, their kicking leg is hypermobile, but then their planting leg is just tight as can be.
So how do you deal with that? That's really, can you speak on that? That's fascinating. So let's move into that realm, because that's common too. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look, you know, if let's say they kick with the right leg, that left hip is always kind of locked up, and they'll actually feel that glute on the left side, the planting leg, just locked up, tightened. And a lot of the glute work, a lot of the sack of buns level two stuff helps tremendously with that, to almost decompress
right
that hip socket a little bit more.
So guess what?
Once that happens, what's that?
So guess what?
What's that?
That's going to be next week's conversation.
Okay.
You know why? Because we love to hear ourselves talk, but I don't know if everybody else wants us to keep talking. So we're going to cut it down. Now, some people will be like, oh, man. But sorry, guys. You got to keep these interviews on the short side, because people don't have the time to listen forever. And it gives us more content for next time.
That works.
But you got me excited about talking about this. I hope I got you excited, listeners, because that's what we're going to hit next week, the significant imbalances between left and right that you find with kickers, punters.
Even soccer players.
Yeah.
You know, working from that standpoint. So.
And, of course, the quarterback.
Yep.
Right? Throwing from that one arm all the time.
Yep. Exactly.
Always dropping back on that one side.
Yeah.
So we'll talk about all that next time. We're going to say goodbye to everybody else. So say goodbye, Jeff. Okay.
All right. Take care. Thank you very much. Everybody have a great week. Go Lions.
Go Lions. And here, everybody, take care. Have a great week. And I'm going to say go Cardinals, because I'm here in Phoenix, Arizona. Thanks for listening, and we'll touch base with you next week. Chris Frederick and Jeff Kong. I'm at www.stretchedwin.com. Till we meet again. Bye-bye.